This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Flashback face. Do you like scary movies? Scream and Revitalisation. I felt that it was so violent and so much back where I had started that I'd screw up my karma if I did it. Director Wes Craven's initial reticence to make what he referred to as one more toff wall horror film was born of his enduring battle against the genre typecasting he had fought throughout his career. The horror genre was widely considered to be in a state of flux, though the script over which he procrastinated was regarded as among the most desirable of 1990s Hollywood. Entitled simply and knowingly Scary Movie, it was the creation of 30-year-old failed actor Kevin Williamson, whose debut screenplay Killing Mrs. Tingle languished in Hollywood's development hell while he endured a period of extended unemployment. It was a whodunit thriller constructed upon a foundation of and satire of 1980s slasher film conventions and the smart, witty teenage characterizations Williamson admired in the oeuvre of John Hughes, screenwriter du jour of iconic 80s teen movies. The script sparked a bidding war amongst the major studios, a war won by Dimension Films, an offshoot of high-profile Hollywood studio Miramax overseen by Bob Weinstein to specifically develop genre movies. They recognized the ambition and novelty of Williamson's conception, as the writer himself outlined. I knew there was nothing new I could add to the slasher genre, so I took every movie I've ever seen and incorporated it into one. I was trying to do what Wes did with A Nightmare on Elm Street, where he redefined the horror movie. Scream, as it was retitled at the studio's insistence, enjoyed a more prestigious release than most from Dimension Films, who had hitherto specialized in formulaic sequels to established horror franchises. Its budget, approximately $15 million, was modest for a major Hollywood release, but above average for a typical horror film of its era. Dimension took the unusual step of opening the film on the 20th of December 1996 in the US, a counter-programming gesture pitting the violent, cynical film against the expected onslaught of family holiday films and traditionally timed pre-Oscar prestige pictures. Dimension's faith in the film reflected the confidence in the material, a script that not only possessed aspirations to commence a trilogy, but crucially set out to deconstruct and revitalize a genre that was perceived as obsolete. Dimension's stablemate Miramax were coming off a vastly profitable union with the decade's premier American auteur Quentin Tarantino, whose own, typically self-aggrandizing views on Scream summarized the key constituents attractive to such a studio. Williamson did with Scream what I did with gangster movies. Horror was pretty much dead when he did that. Not only did he revitalize it and give some respect to the slasher genre, but he even commented on why all these other horror films have been so crappy. Horror films, perhaps more than any other genre, are renowned for being front-loaded in the realm of the American box office. While opening weekend remains the core barometer of US box office analysis, theatrically released horror films typically follow a pattern of attracting the core horror fan audience in their first weekend of release, alongside the more casual, stereotypically teenage audiences enticed by the prospect of a scary, gross-out date movie. A sharp financial drop-off traditionally follows in the subsequent week, typically averaging between 60 and 70%. In 2009, the Platinum Dunes remake of Friday the 13th displayed an even more significant drop, losing an almost unprecedented 80% of its initial $40 million weekend gross. Scream, however, subverted this trend completely. Its modest first weekend drew $6 million, before unusually rapturous word of mouth saw the movie sustain itself like few others. Emulating the uncharacteristic nature of its performance, Dimension persisted with their promotional push well into January 1997, even ultimately re-releasing the movie, ahead of its home video releases, in April of the same year, easing the movie over the $100 million benchmark domestically and resulting in an atypically impressive 30 weeks in US theaters. Scream, ironically, never topped the American box office charts, but its slow-burn success reaped more financial rewards than the two subsequent sequels in 1997 and 2000 that opened at number one before fading in a more traditional fashion. Producer Carrie Woods enthusiastically captured the film's crossover achievement, and unwittingly prefigured the opening sequence of Scream 2, which depicts a typical opening night horror film audience, with a sense of anarchic audience participation more akin to the interactive theatrical appreciation of niche cult films such as the Rocky Horror Picture Show, 1975. Fig 1. A communal experience. People are seeing Scream 5 or 6 times. It's become a communal experience. They're repeating lines from it. Also unusual for the movie's initial release was a brace of strong reviews. While prominent critics like Janet Maslin of the New York Times and Richard Corliss of Time magazine were unimpressed, and in fact seemed to favor Wes Craven's New Nightmare 1994, which had opened to the best reviews of its director's career, Scream enjoyed the kind of acclaim that has rarely adorned the genre in any decade. Although more specifically targeting late teenage audiences, Scream shared the sense of genre revisionism, cinematic knowledge, self-awareness and smart-mouth character interaction of equally well-reviewed crossover hits from rival self-confessed movie geeks Quentin Tarantino and Kevin Smith. Smith shared Williamson's particular affection for John Hughes, while both he and Tarantino relentlessly referenced iconic films, usually of immediately preceding decades, via individual set pieces, dialogue, characterization or soundtrack selections. Ultimately, Craven's trepidation about returning to horror made him an unlikely celebrity. The filmmaker who achieved infamy for unleashing The Last House on the Left, 1972, could now be found winning MTV's Movie of the Year award and appearing on primetime TV talk shows. Meanwhile, the inevitable avalanche of new wave slasher thrillers followed, resulting in a surge of theatrically released horror films to complement the usual proliferation of straight-to-home video releases. Many of these self-consciously incorporated, often in a fleeting fashion, the knowing attitude of Scream, and suddenly phrases like postmodern and meta were being routinely deployed in reviews of films as quickly forgotten as Do You Wanna Know a Secret, 2001, and Cherry Falls, 2000. Variety summarized the craze. Scream sent a shockwave through the industry. Suddenly everyone wanted to get their hands on hip in-your-face fright pics that could be made on the cheap, and would gross $100 million from teens dying to see teens dying. Scream is undeniably a prominent modern horror text, and it has proved to be a highly influential one in the two decades since its release. This monograph will consider the film's place in the oeuvre of director Wes Craven, questioning its status as a true Wes Craven film from an auteurist standpoint. I will examine the perception of the film as a rejuvenation of the horror genre, while considering its creation and success as a familiar example of the cyclical trend of Hollywood hybridization and its tone as being consistent with earlier efforts to revive the horror genre during a fallow period. Scream will be positioned in the context of a cycle of 90s films sometimes referenced as horror films for people who don't like horror films, and which enjoyed blockbuster-level productions and grosses by adapting codes and conventions of the genre in a more prestigious and commercial thriller format. Furthermore, an examination of the marketing of Scream will consider how its conception as a genre hybrid echoed earlier examples from the original slasher film cycle, films that equally strive to attract the widest possible audience by appealing in particular to female audience members, traditionally not part of the recognized horror film demographic, via specific characterizations and subplots. I will consider how the film's timing was pivotal to its success, notably in relation to a technologically sophisticated and cinematically informed audience with unprecedented expanding access to media. One chapter will note the many varying definitions of what constitutes a postmodern text and their relevance to the themes and approaches of Scream, while viewing its intricate self-reflexive structure as a necessity within a format whose tropes had long been considered clichéd, a subgenre that, as early as it was considered a subgenre, was already prone to self-reflection and deconstruction. Given its incorporation of and acknowledgement of fan culture and the cinematic knowledge of all its key characters, I will question the film's true gift to the horror genre by analyzing its portrayal of horror film rules, its potentially damaging stance on movie violence, its depiction of horror fans, and ultimately, the derogatory reaction Scream received from certain sectors of horror fandom. In a fascinating paradox, the movie that, for so many analysts, single-handedly represented horror's comeback, was not universally loved by horror fans and in certain respects undermines both them and the genre, unintentionally or not. Synopsis. Following the savage murders of Casey, Drew Barrymore, and Steve, Kevin Patrick Walls, their friends and peers from Woodsboro High School reflect on the gruesome details of their demise. A media circus hits the small town, spearheaded by ambitious self-aggrandizing reporter Gail Weathers, Courtney Cox, who is insulting to her crew members and callous in her eagerness to cover the crime in as much salacious detail as possible. Some of the school friends, including renowned horror film geek Randy, Jamie Kennedy, and hyperactive stew Matthew Lillard, joke amongst each other that they or anyone could be the mystery killer. Stu's good friend Billy Loomis, Skeet Ulrich, laments the failure to consummate his relationship with virginal sensitive Sydney Prescott, Neve Campbell. A year ago, almost to the day, Sydney's mother Maureen was sexually assaulted and murdered, apparently by Coton Weary, Lee F. Schreiber, currently on death row awaiting appeal. The television news, while gloating about the details of the new crimes in Woodsboro, waste no time in cheerfully reminding viewers of the anniversary of Maureen's death, while Sydney's true friends trip over themselves attempting to not reference it. Sydney becomes the target of a mysterious phone caller, initially dismissing it as one of Randy's pranks thanks to the proliferation of scary movie references, but soon after she is attacked by the killer, disguised via a Halloween mask inspired by Edward Munch's The Scream, and proves strong enough to fend off her assailant. The older brother of Sydney's cynical friend Tatum, Rose McGowan, Dewey, David Arquette, disparagingly nicknamed Doofus, is at the forefront of the investigation despite appearing to be squeamish and meek. The older authorities in town, including the sheriff, Joseph Whip, lament today's youth culture as much as the embittered school principal, Henry Winkler. Sydney manages to escape further attacks, while Randy's vast horror movie knowledge provides a recurring commentary on the parallels to 1980s slasher films, and the media enthusiastically ponder over who might be next. Following the killings of Principal Himbry and Tatum, Billy seduces Sydney into giving up her virginity. With the body count rising, Randy decides the time is right to educate his friends on the three golden rules of surviving a horror movie, having come to the realization that they are, in effect, living a real-life horror movie. After Dewey, Gail, and Gail's cameraman are all attacked to varying degrees of injury, Sydney is confronted by the revelation that Stu and Billy are responsible for the murder spree. Billy explains how he blames Sydney, and in particular Sydney's mother, for wrecking his family's livelihood, while Stu cites peer pressure as his motive for assisting the murders. Both claim that violent films gave them some inspiration, but make it clear that they were already predisposed to psychopathic behavior. Despite plans to frame Sydney's absentee father for the murders, Stu and Billy fail in their mission thanks to the combined efforts of Sydney, Gail, and Randy, all of whom survive against the odds alongside Dewey, who is largely out of action for the final confrontation. Footnotes. 1. Woolley, 2011-183. 2. Ebert. 3. Williamson in Fangoria, issue 159, January 1997-24. 4. Perrin, 2012-138. 5. Information pertaining to U.S. box office statistics courtesy of www.boxofficemojo.com. 6. http://www.nytimes.com/1997/06/12/movie/long-live-a-truly-good-scare.html. 7. Quoted in Perrin, 2012-113. On First Blood, the opening of Scream. The first character we see on screen in Scream the movie and in its theatrical trailer is Casey, portrayed by Drew Barrymore in a sequence generally regarded as an arresting self-contained set piece, even by those not enamored with the film as a whole. It serves as a short film in its own right, priming the audience for what Kevin Williamson defined as the film's principal gimmick: horror movies do exist in our movie. The writer explained how he considered the best way to scare an increasingly jaded and culturally aware audience was to make a horror film about teenagers who know the genre as well as they do. Scream acknowledges the standard role of a prologue in a slasher film is to either follow the terrorization and murder of a short-lived character as a means of establishing the antagonist prior to the introduction of the central characters, or as a way of conveying a catalytic past event instrumental in provoking the upcoming rampage. Opting for the latter structural convention would have entailed Scream opening with a visualization of the rape murder of Maureen Prescott. However brutal it may be, the stalking and killing of Casey, an attractive young woman with whom the target audience could identify, offers a far more commercial prospect than the violation and killing of a parental figure. An inherent squeamishness at explicitly adding matriarchs to the body count of slasher films was earlier typified by the uncharacteristically discreet fashion in which such a character is dismissed in Friday the 13th, the final chapter, 1984. Employing Casey as the focus of what is designed to be a shocking yet crowd-pleasing sequence simultaneously enables a proficient confirmation of the film's narrative raison d'etre. We are witness to a demise caused by a character's failure to be sufficiently horror-savvy. Following the Dimension logo, the movie, like an increasing number of mainstream Hollywood films, dispenses with a full opening title sequence. The film's title simply spread eagles itself across the screen, the M in Scream sharpened to a pair of knife-like points, and is accompanied in quick succession by two audio signifiers of threat in the slasher subgenre, a piercing non-specific scream and a shrill ringing telephone. Both these tropes are inextricably linked to slasher cinema, with Jamie Lee Curtis horror's most celebrated scream queen, thanks to her participation in slasher movies, though the title and lineage stretches at least as far back as Fay Wray in King Kong, 1933, just as the notion of telephonic terrorization owes a strong debt to vintage thrillers like Sorry, Wrong Number, 1948. The title itself is less overtly knowing than Scary Movie, but still suggests a self-conscious revisionism of genre tropes. The name itself has precedence in Byron Quisenberry's curious slasher western hybrid Scream, 1981, and also the film within a film showcased in the self-referential The Last Horror Film, 1982, from the same cycle. The hackneyed language of a slasher film is instantly acknowledged. The first on-screen dialogue is Casey answering the telephone by asking, "Who is this?" Later on, similar scripting cliches like "I'll be right back" and "Who's there?" will be highlighted as groan-inducing subgenre standards by the film's characters. Here, its usage reflects Casey's fate as a character who unwittingly transforms into a conventional horror film victim by making all the wrong choices when the killer substitutes audio harassment for physical violence. Peter M. Nichols wittily summarizes the scenario simply as: monumentally gullible high school lass trapped alone in her big glass house like some MTV Little Miss Moffat. The ominous caller is voiced by Roger Jackson, who represented the vocals of all the killers in the four Scream films due to an apparently universal gender-defying voice-changing device, updated to a mobile phone app when the technology had evolved in the final sequel, employed by each antagonist. His vocals provide continuity, alongside the killer's costume of choice, for a series that otherwise lacks the consistent, indestructible threat of rival slasher franchises. At this stage in the film, the audience is unaware that this is not the killer's actual voice, but its employment reinforces our assumption of a masculine adversary, despite the slasher genre's various female killers. Casey, settling down to watch some scary movie, unspecified perhaps to imply the interchangeability of so much then contemporary horror product, alone at home, is interrogated about her favorite genre films, while visual indicia of looming violence proliferate. The knife rack with which she toys while talking, or the squeaking garden swing on which she will be decoratively displayed for the sequence's punchline. The former is calculated to raise a knowing smile even from audience members with a cursory knowledge of the iconography associated with a subgenre galvanized by the shower murder in Psycho. Fig 2. Casey Becker playfully forecasting the imminent violence. The scene and the slasher format itself has its origins in an enduring urban legend sometimes referred to as the babysitter and the man upstairs. Its most obvious cinematic precedent is the self-contained prologue of Fred Walton's When a Stranger Calls, 1979, in which a sitter is repeatedly terrorized by calls insinuating the murder of her charges, calls ultimately traced to upstairs, where such a deed has already been accomplished. The Scream caller's visceral response to his victim's panicked query of "What do you want?" is altered, marginally, from Walton's "Your blood all over me" to a more appropriately extreme 1990s, "To see what your insides look like," the progress of technology, albeit to a clunky mid-90s mobile phone that dates the movie more than its soundtrack, ensures this killer can feasibly be anywhere at any time to taunt his prey rather than arduously route it to a traceable alternative phone line upstairs. This being the era of cumbersome dial-up internet, sustained threat via instant messaging was not yet a possibility. Curiously, Walton's film is one of the few obvious precursors to Scream not to be name-checked on screen, as part of Williamson's relentless bid to be one step ahead of the audience's mental box ticking of inspirations and homages. Casey isn't babysitting like Jill in When a Stranger Calls or Laurie in Halloween, 1978. She is preparing to watch a movie by making popcorn, the food of choice for public and private movie experiences. Chances are, given the scene's early position in the film, Casey prepares popcorn just as the audience is eating theirs. The blue light of her television, a widely recognizable pre-HD signifier of having just watched a movie or of preparing to watch a movie, figures prominently in the background throughout the sequence, enhancing the sense that the first sequence in Scream is designed for consumers to appreciate even more in a domestic setting, increasingly the sole fate of horror features in this period, just as the opposing prologue of Scream 2 must be seen in a lively theatrical environment for maximum impact. With every individual scene in Scream referencing in some way an entire generation's media-saturated lifestyles, the television set will become increasingly salient in the narrative, until finally it becomes an active participant in sealing the doom of one of the antagonists in the final tete-a-tete. Just as Casey's murder sets the entire plot in motion, the framing of key moments during the prologue around the TV introduces the overriding significance of contemporary culture's most commonly absorbed media form to the unfolding narrative. Fig 3. Scream's best-known star Drew Barrymore and the omnipresent TV set. The script needs Casey to do all the wrong things and to face long-established slasher clichés and conventions in order for her to fall victim to the killer with relative ease, unlike the resilient, seemingly infallible female character Sydney, Neve Campbell, introduced in the very next scene. Casey, despite being portrayed by a well-known and charismatic actress, is cannon fodder like so many forgotten slasher victims of the earlier era. A Halloween-inspired Steadicam follows her around the house to emphasize her vulnerability, while familiar wide shots of Casey cowering and whimpering in the corner of the frame are used as an obvious distraction to the large object contrived to crash through the window on stage right. Casey's survivalist weaknesses as she backs away without looking what she might be backing into are criticized by her own nemesis, who mocks her by noting, "You might as well come out and investigate a strange noise or something." Reflecting the film's repeated efforts to highlight the apparent sexism of its 80s predecessors, Drew Barrymore's previously exploited sex appeal, the major selling point of her initial foray into adult roles, is de-emphasized. Unbecoming blonde bob wig aside, the costuming choices for Casey notably led a nervous Bob Weinstein to question during production why one of his hot young starlets was wearing a baggy sweater. In a movie called Scream, Casey is unable to do so when given an opportunity to cry for help to her fast-approaching parents, and her final action is to display a clear sign of recognition, in the fashion of the last breaths of many earlier whodunit-based genre films, of her assailant before his fatal stab. The sequence ends with the discovery of her corpse by her nearest and dearest, a premature and singular echo of all those climactic signature slasher film moments in which the heroine stumbles across the strategically placed corpses of her friends, falling out of cupboards, pinned to spontaneously opening doors, etc., like some malicious jack-in-the-box prank to preempt her own potentially imminent demise. Scream repeats, without irony, the flawed logic inherent in these scenes. The moment relies on the unlikely notion that the killer would have had time to stage the gruesomely inventive tableau in such a minuscule time frame, but at this stage a cynically questioning audience would be oblivious to its twist revelation of two killers working in tandem. Few sequences in the self-aware slasher movies that followed, including Scream's own sequels, were as adept at integrating the acceptance of audience preconceptions and knowledge with a genuinely intense suspense scenario. the increasingly nervous movie trivia game that establishes Halloween, Casey's favorite scary movie, as a key participant within Scream's narrative itself echoes the phoned-in pop quiz, Riddles and Threats of Domestic Terrorist Dennis Hopper in Speed, 1994, a keynote 90s action movie that quickly entered the cultural zeitgeist. The killer's declaration of "I wanna play a game" prefigures the elaborate work of John Kramer in the Saw franchise 2004, whereby victims are required to pass a series of extreme morality-based tests in order to survive but, like Casey, fail miserably to avoid the mutilations demanded by the bloodthirsty audience. Casey displays a common misconception in the realm of horror film trivia, incorrectly identifying Jason as the killer in the original Friday the 13th, 1980, an error that signifies her as a casual horror viewer, like much of this film's intended target audience, rather than a Fangoria reading horror buff. This specific genre faux pas will be the only occasion in which a character's fate, in this case, Casey's boyfriend Steve, will be decided via a quiz-style knowledge test, though it broadly establishes the prevailing theme of empowerment via genre awareness. As Andrew Sidder notes, a command of its world demands not so much knowledge of the laws of nature as a mastery of the laws of the slasher film. Knowledge of the textual conventions of the slasher film is crucial to the character's survival. As the film enforces the notion that its characters will be endangered for not following the rules, which at this point have not been fully conveyed to us, its tone is able to oscillate in a fashion that felt fresh and exciting for many audiences of the time, as Sidder conveys. Whereas the play between light and dark in gothic horror movies like Cat People established a certain relationship between perception and knowledge, in Scream's prologue, we are encouraged to read such plays on perception more in terms of the rhetorical conventions of the slasher genre. The playfulness of the reference points in Williamson's script extends to Craven's own work. Of the Nightmare on Elm Street franchise, Casey observes, "The first one was okay, but the rest sucked." The sentiment echoes Craven's script for Wes Craven's New Nightmare, 1994, in which actress Heather Langenkamp's limo driver confirms his belief that the first was the best, within a narrative unsubtly decrying the dilution of Craven's original conception of evil via a series of increasingly camp sequels. It is a visual quote from a notorious, oft-censored moment from Craven's The Last House on the Left, however.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.